those today, we've been reading out of the Old Testament and following on the Old Testament readings. I have done some of this with Boy Scouts of America, as I'm a Boy Scout leader as well. And what we do is we teach interfaith religion, which means we're working with people who are of the Hebrew faith, Muslims, Buddhists, and Protestants, Catholics, everyone. So we try to read to make them the most comfortable. But it does not exclude Jesus from our readings. It does not exclude Jesus from our services, even as scouts. It's just we're trying to be inclusive of all religions. One of my favorite services was actually during a training that I had, which we had the reading of the Book of Mormon after that. So it was a very interesting experience for me, not being familiar with that book. So with that, this passage out of Exodus was something that I really gravitated towards for my message. And I've read this message to the Boy Scouts. I'm going to do it again this spring. So those people who are doing the Ordre Nero section conclave, you're going to get this again. But with this, it's an interesting look at leadership. But before I start, let's do a quick word of prayer. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock, my redeemer. Amen. Now, leadership is what scouting is all the programs are supposed to be teaching our youth. As adults, we're supposed to be the example of good leadership. Our program of guidance requires us to include our youth in this leadership journey. It is evidence that we learn from our leadership style. It is evidence that we learn our leadership style from examples. I have a story about two leaders. The story goes that sometime close to a battlefield over 200 years ago, a man in civilian clothes rode past a small group of exhausted, battle-weary soldiers, digging in obviously important defensive positions. The sergeant, making no effort to help, was shouting orders, threatening punishment if the work was not completed within the hour. "Why are you not helping?" asked the stranger on horseback. "I am in charge." "The men do as I tell them," said the sergeant, adding, "help them yourself if you feel strongly about it." To the sergeant's surprise, the stranger dismounted and helped the men until the job was finished. Before leaving, the stranger congratulated the men for their work and approached the puzzled sergeant. "You should notify top command next time your rank prevents you from supporting your men, and I will provide a more permanent solution," said the stranger. Up close, the sergeant now recognized General Washington and also the lesson he'd just been taught. While this story is likely not true, it makes us think. Which leader are you? More importantly, which leader are you striving to be? Let's look at the styles of leadership. And I'll be honest, this portion of my message is a mixture of a message, a scout message that I found online, as well as part of a daily Bible reading I was following last fall, but it really spoke to me. And they use one example, Lao Tzu, father of 1,000, and he had a nice quote. "The best leader is one that the people are barely aware of. The next best is one who is loved and praised by the people. Next comes one who is feared. Worst is one who is despised. If the leader does not have enough faith in his people, they will not have faith in him. The best leader puts great value in words and says little, so that when his work is finished, the people say, we did it ourselves." The other leader is much closer to us as scouts, both boy and girl scouts. And he said, "Leadership is the keynote to success, and leadership is difficult to define, and leaders are difficult to find. I have frequently stated that any ass can be a commander, and a trained man may often make an instructor, but a leader is more like a poet, born, not manufactured." This was Lord Baden-Powell, the founder of Boy Scouts, and also very influential in Girl Scouts in America. The first leadership style is authoritarian leaders. They get things done, but the scouter's goal is much broader than efficiency in completing tasks. Scouting has well-defined expectations, but these are not enforced in an obedience-oriented, authoritarian manner. We want our scouts to be obedient, but we do not want them to be frightened. We encourage them to ask questions and respond by helping them find the answers. These are Lao Tzu's spirit leader and Baden-Powell's commander. This is the sergeant in the story I started with. When we were young, we gravitated towards this style because this is what we see. We see it in a lot of sports. We see it on TV. And this is a lot of our parenting styles, and I'm guilty of that too. Permissive leaders are usually unsure of themselves and look for reassurance and approval of their friendship of others. For all their effort, permissive leaders are neither respect nor friendship. More often than not, they end up with people laughing behind their backs. Following our two examples, this is Lao Tzu's despised leader and being held to great man. Responsive leadership is barely perceptible influence that empowers people to do things for themselves by listening more than talking, exercising goodwill, and having an unshakable faith in their people. Responsive leaders create an atmosphere of shared accomplishment. Rather than dictating their own wishes, they inspire others to adopt high expectations. Their example of service is a powerful motivation and force. When difficulties arise, they respond with empathy and compassion. As we continue our comparison, this is Lao Tzu's leader that people are barely aware of, and being Mao's poet. Now, with us learning these different leadership styles, we're missing the most common in volunteer organizations. That's the reluctant leader. This is usually coupled with one of the three leadership styles I just covered, but neither one of the individuals I've talked about covers this category. But the Bible does in Exodus, where we have Moses leading his people out of Egypt. I find great comfort and encouragement in this passage we read today. I'm quite shy and introverted by nature, and a reluctant leader. I find it enormously encouraging that even a great leader, like Moses, was a reluctant leader, and that he tried to make excuses as to why he should not do what God was calling him to do. Let's look at his five excuses that's shown to us in the Bible. You have got the wrong person. Moses says, "Who am I?" He felt inadequate. We can all feel, "I'm not good enough, I'm not holy enough." Moses said to God, "You got the wrong person. Why me?" God replies, "I will be with you. That is all that matters. I'm not ready yet." Moses says, "What shall I tell them?" He felt ill-informed. He did not think he would be able to answer all the questions. He thought he would have nothing to say, but God said, "This is what you are to say." God will give us the message at the right time. "I might fail." Moses says, "What happens if all goes wrong? It might not work out. What if they do not believe me or listen to me and say the Lord did not appear to you?" God showed him his power. "I do not have the skills." Moses says, "I do not have the right gifts. Oh Lord, I have never been eloquent. I am slow of speech and tongue." And it seems that Moses may have had a stutter or some other type of speech impediment. God said, "I will help you speak and will teach you what to say." God's strength is made perfect in weakness. "Someone else will do it." Moses says, "Please send someone else to do it. It is easier to think that someone else will do it better than you." God was not pleased with Moses, but said, "You would send Aaron to be with them. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do." Eventually, Moses agreed to go God's way and follow God's call. Then all the battles started. Things got worse rather than better. Pharaoh's way was not God's way. Moses and Aaron faced criticism and opposition from their own people. Moses complained to God that he had not done what he promised to do. God responded to Moses' complaint by giving him a clearer vision to who he is. God said, "I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty. But by my name, the Lord, I did not make myself known to them." In a few sentences, God revealed more of his character to Moses. He showed that he is faithful and keeps his word. He demonstrated that he suffers with us and feels our pain. He guarantees deliverance and freedom. He brings us to an intimate relationship with himself and leads us to our inheritance and takes us home. But when Moses tells the people all this, they refuse to listen to Moses because of their impatience and anguish of spirit and because of their cruel bondage. Moses complains to God that the very thing he fears has happened. He says that the people have not listened to me. How then shall Pharaoh give heed to me? Who am I but deficient in the heed of speech? so often the biblical pattern. First comes God's call and vision, then follows all the challenges and difficulties before we see the promise fulfilled. And we see this in our real lives today, too. God's way is not always easy. It is extraordinarily challenging. But at the end of the day, it is wonderfully fulfilling. And if you don't know the conclusion of the story, God has provided it to us in the Bible. Many of you can identify with these excuses, or some variation of them. I use them fairly recently, too. We can fail to look outside our own problems to recognize that there are sources to help us. We fear the unknown, which typically holds a lot of responsibility. Why can't someone else do it? We are chosen by our colleagues and by God to lead. We must remember that God is watching over us, much as our scout leaders watch over us. Do you always get what you want to be? Do you feel like you struggle unnecessarily? I do, and so did Moses. God sends you the help you need, though through what feels sometimes like a divine intervention. When the ideas feel like they just come to you, or you find the right resource on your own. Sometimes God sends others to aid you, other scouts or your adult leaders, much like he sent Aaron to help Moses. We adults, being responsible leaders, ask questions and try to get you to see your own answer through a hands-off approach. God does the same. He asks you to take on responsibility in your home, your troop, and your community. He does not always provide the answers, but he does provide the support. Seek your answers through prayer. God is listening. He will answer you as he answered those with you and before you. Now, with that said, we do have several opportunities for the youth to work with their faith and earn different awards. Girl Scouts has a special award, and I'd like two ladies to come up to me real quick, Lillian and Izzy. I don't do a lot of presentations for churches. Probably not the most appropriate place, but since this is My Promise, My Faith, this is an award, it's a Girl Scout award, that they have to pick in line with the Girl Scout ball. And Izzy's going to freak out. Izzy, what line did you pick? So Izzy picked Courageous and Strong, and Lillian, which did you pick? To be a sister to every Girl Scout. And what the requirements say is they have to pick their line with the Girl Scout ball. Then they have to find a woman of their faith and ask them how they use that line in their everyday lives. They pick a story and read that story with us, their parents. And they also pick three quotes. And for that, they receive a small pin that goes on their vest. So, Katrina will get a little bit nervous. Congratulations. Congratulations. For Girl Scouts, they can earn this every year they're a Girl Scout. So there's two pins. You see Lillian has one on her vest right now, and she'll have a second now with this one. Izzy's a first-year Brownie, so she'll have one. And we keep pushing this program. Ladies, you may have a seat. Thank you. Yep. The other program that we ended up trying to push for the church is the Pray program, and you'll see a display in Williams Hall about that, and that is for Sunday school students, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, any youth as a member of the church, even if you're not a member of the church, you may participate and get our spin on that program as the Methodist Church. So feel free to stop by for that. With that said, if you'd like to join me in the prayer presentation, I'll bring this bulletin so I don't know if it's printed in there, so tell me if I'm wrong. O Lord, grant that we may so carry out in our lives the spirit of the Scout laws, that we may teach those others by living it for ourselves.